Thank you. Amen. John said, please don't embarrass New Jersey. So I'm going to do my best. Thank you for your encouragement, John. I appreciate it. Well, it's such an honor to be here today. I'm just so grateful for my tribe. This is my tribe. And thankful for Chuck and the whole Glory of Zion team, for Bill Suddeth and Sylvie and Chris Hayward, John and Cheryl and Gannett, everybody that's here. Doris is not here right now, but Linda and Robert Heidler, I just really appreciate everybody here. All right. So we have what are some of the manifestations of fear? I'm sure you all know them, but I just thought I'd put them up there. This is just some that I thought of. Anxiety, dread, distress, worry, all cause our self-talk to affect our emotions, right? What's your self-talk like? What are you constantly saying about yourself? Ungodly beliefs are a breeding ground for fear, right? Where we even though we know we come to church 8 times a week, we hear the scriptures, but when you're in a situation, what has final say, the word or what you think?
Yeah.
So that's what's really important here. So we have irrational thinking. We have a negative outlook on things. So we know the scripture in 1 Timothy 1:7, it says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear or timidity, but of power, love, and of sound mind or a disciplined mind. So I looked up the words, the definition, fear, the Greek word is delia, and it means fearfulness or dread. He's saying, I didn't give you that. But he says, but I gave you power, and that's dunamis, power, ability, force, strength, violence, work, miracle, might, virtue, mighty work, power for performing miracles. So you have to meditate on it. He didn't say you're a little wimpy Christian and you know what? It's your problem. Don't bother me. He's saying, listen, you have the power of God in you. Now you have a choice to develop it or you have a choice to back down and let your behind get kicked. So then it says here, for we have fear, power, we have sound mind. Listen to this. This is so good. And the Greek word is sophroneo, something like that, which pictures a mind that has been delivered, rescued, revived, salvaged, and protected, and is now safe and secure. That's what that word means. Now, Rick Renner wrote in one of the Jules book, I forgot what it's called, but on this scripture it says here, God has not given you a spirit of fear, but of power and of love. He has given you a mind that has been delivered, rescued, revived, salvaged, protected, and brought into a place of safety and security, so it is no longer affected by illogical, unfounded, and absurd thoughts. Isn't that good? That's our mind has been delivered. It's rescued. He's saying, listen, you speak to that thing. You speak to that spirit. You don't let it tell you what to do. We have to fan that flame. In 1 Timothy 4, well, actually, 1 Timothy, I don't have it on the computer. In 1 Timothy 4:14, in the Passion, it says, don't minimize the powerful gift that operates in your life. Don't minimize who you are. I want you to see yourself. We're going to talk a little bit about imagination, but I want you to see yourself as a warrior, as a mighty warrior. You have to know who you are in Christ. And that he loves you with an everlasting love, and he put his DNA in us. The Bible says we have the mind of Christ. And that we can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens us. And we can't allow the limitations of our thought to hold us back. So he says here, don't minimize that powerful gift. It was imparted to you. Listen, I had fear imparted to me. My mother was always afraid. And, you know, I mean, she was tough. She lived through the war. But, you know, same with all of us. I mean, we grew up inner city. So you had to learn to fight and act tough, even though you weren't really tough because you were really afraid. But then this fear thing, no matter what we did, what are you doing? Oh, my God. I would take a deep breath. And she said, oh, my God, it's your kidneys. I said, Mom, I'm taking a deep breath. I don't have kidney problems. But she says, no, don't tell me you have a kidney problem. This is my mother, you know. So, you know, there was always fear in the house, you know, always talking about all the negative stuff. I had to come out of agreement with that. So you have the spirit realm, but you also have just habitual things that you do and that you're used to, right? So 1 Timothy 4:14 says, don't neglect this gift. We have to fan it. We have to allow the fire of God to burn. 2 Timothy 1:6, it says, I'm writing to encourage you to fan into a flame. No, hold on. Let me start over. In a passion. I'm writing to encourage you to fan into flame and rekindle the fire of the spiritual gift God imparted to you. We have to stir that fire up on our hearts. We have to stir it up. You can't be passionless. We are to be passionate for Jesus. So Leviticus 6:13 says, the fire shall be burning continually on the altar, and it shall not be allowed to go out. Now, I don't think I have any of this on the handout. Let me just say this really quick. In 1 Kings 18:30 and 31 in the Amplified, when Elisha was dealing with Jezebel and the prophets of Baal, you know, he said, how long will you falter between these two opinions, right? And so, all right, they're mocking. He's mocking them, and, you know, all this stuff is going on. And before he went to call the fire down, he said to the people, come and let's rebuild this altar. And I'll read it to you out of verse 30. It says, Elisha said to all the people, come near to me. And the people approached him, and he repaired and rebuilt the old altar of the Lord that had been torn down by Jezebel. Now, that word repair there means rapha. It's healing. We have to get healing in our hearts. We have to allow the disappointments and the discouragements or whatever it is, the unforgiveness, to be healed. We have to rebuild our altar time, our intimate time with the Lord in this. I'm telling it like never before. We've always had to do it, but we have to do it. And so it says, then Elijah took 12 stones. What's 12? Governmental. There's a new kingdom alignment as we're getting into that deep place with the Lord to hear strategies for the alignment for what's ahead. And he said, in accordance with the number of the tribes of Jacob. And then what happened was he then called down the fire. But then what happened after that, and this is what how fear comes in, this is an amazing thing. Kills the 450 prophets of Baal. And then what happens in 1 Kings 19:1-5 in the message, Ahab, like a little baby, reported to Jezebel everything that Elijah had done, including the massacre of the prophets. Jezebel immediately sent a messenger to Elisha with her threat. Now, that demonic representative is what comes after us. When we're taking a bold stand for something, when we're not straddling the fence, right? We're not wavering. We are standing for God. The Bible says when you've done all to stand, you stand. And then you stand and you stand. And that actually means to stand on the covenant promises of God. You stand and you don't back down. But then there's a messenger that's sent to you to try to bring you down. But that's what you have to be aware of, because the Bible says we have to know the devices of the enemy, right? We also have to know the way he operates, and we know that he's going to come. He's a liar. The Bible says he's a thief. How does it go? The thief doesn't come but to steal, kill, and destroy, but I've come to give you that abundant life. He's a thief. So he's going to try to come and steal that victory that you had, to make you look foolish, to say it wasn't really God. But we have to be on guard. Now, God came and ministered to Elisha, but then they had gotten Jehu and the other guy to, you know, take out Jezebel. But the thing is, we have to be aware of that. Don't be surprised when you get that tries to come after you. These messengers are no lightweight thing. I mean, but greater is he that's in us. See, if you recognize that, wait a second, I'm not receiving that. You intercept it. You know, like Wonder Woman, she would do all her, you know, she would intercept the word. You know, that's what we can do. We intercept it. Okay, we're good? All right. So, I think the next hand, all right. So in Joshua 1, are you there? Okay, so listen to this. Now, Joshua, they were all ready to cross over into, it was a new era. Moses was dead. Now they're getting ready to cross over. And this is the instruction that God gave them before they were crossing over. Of course, they had to sanctify themselves and do all that. But before he even said to do that, this is what he said. In Joshua 1, in the New Living Translation, no one will be able to stand against you as long as you live, for I will be with you as I was with Moses. I will not fail you or abandon you. Be strong and courageous, for you are the one who will lead these people to possess all the land I swore to their ancestors and I would give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be very careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the left or to the right. Then you will be successful in everything you do. Study the book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night so that you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. This is my command. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged. So do you think the Lord knows that that's something that we battle? Fear and discouragement? He's saying, listen, I want you to be bold. I want you to be courageous. So if he wants us to be that way, then we need to do our due diligence in learning what to do. And we need to get in spiritual shape. So in the Amplified, I'm just like, because it said intimidated here. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified or dismayed or intimidated, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. So let's look at some of the definitions here. Strong is chazaz, I don't know how to say it, but it means to become strong, strengthened, courageous, to conquer and to become obstinate. So it means it's the Lord saying, listen, you can do this. I don't want to hear that you're weak or, you know, we've always been timid or we have to back down. That's not what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. He wants you to understand you can be strong. Courage means to be brave and to be secure, to be determined. Today, I want you to leave this place with everything that everyone's saying, to be determined to make that shift. Only you can do it. Listen, there is some impartation, and you're going to receive impartation today. But we all have to make a decision that I'm not backing down, that I'm not going backwards. I'm moving forward, and you better get out of my way because I have the Spirit of the living God living within me. See, we have to make that decision. Get out of your mindset. You smack yourself if you start talking weak. Don't do it. Say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do this. I had to say that. I had scripture posted all over the place because this fear thing, it was like we're double-minded. That's what it means. But I felt as though I had a disease and some mental issues that I had. I get in trouble if I say some of these things, so I'm being careful. I 1 minute I'm firm and I'm strong, and the next minute this fear would grip me that was overwhelming, that you can't do it. Sit down. Be quiet. Shut your mouth. Don't you dare go and do this. Don't you try to get a new job. Don't you try to excel in anything. Don't you dare go to school and get a degree. It was constant. This ever happen to anybody? He says, be determined. And I thought, you know what? I am done with this. We have to get to a point where I'm done with being bullied. I'm done with the enemy trying to take me out. You have to say, no, I'm going to walk in my inheritance. I'm going to do what God has called me to do, because that's what he's after, your destiny. He's saying, you're not fulfilling your destiny. Well, you have to say, oh, I am filling my destiny. I'm going to do what God has called me to do.